Good morning. My name is Jesus Tarifa, and I graduated from the College of Idaho in 2011. I'm here today as a recipient of the Alumni Service Award for my work with the Idaho Hispanic Youth Symposium, the Idaho Latino Scholarship Foundation, the College of Idaho's Business Advisory Council, and Jesse Tree. I would like to start off by thanking everyone who made this possible, my mom, who's one of four audience members here today, my brother Nico, my stepdad Eric, and my fellow Yotes who've always believed in me and made this possible, starting with my favorite Yote, my better half, Michelle Woodson, my friends Adan de la Paz, Eliza Ausis, Ali Robbie, and Doug Brigham. Thank you for this opportunity, for having me here today. I want to take you back to a moment in 1999, a moment that changed my life forever. 1999 was the first time I went back to Bolivia since moving to the United States with my mother. And when you go to Bolivia, you travel to a different place. You travel to a very magical destination. Bolivia is a country full of diversity, full of rich culture, sounds, sights, a beautiful country. And when you arrive in La Paz, my hometown, you arrive at an airport that's 13,000 feet above sea level. And the view literally takes your breath away. And when you arrive there, you see the Andes Mountains. You see the city of La Paz that sits in a valley. You see the cliffs. You see the hustle and bustle of a city of 2 million people up in the Andes Mountains. And I was very excited. It was the first time, like I said, that I'd gone back to Bolivia as a child since moving to the United States. And I was excited to see my grandparents. I was excited to spend a school year with all of my friends that I had left behind. And as we were leaving the airport, mind you, we're in a city called El Alto, which is up on the Andes Plateau. And to go from El Alto, from the airport, down to the city of La Paz, you have to cross this sea of people, this sea of cars. And I remember looking out, and you could see in the distance Mount Illimani. And Illimani is the best greeting you can have as a paseño, someone from La Paz. It's your welcome home. And I remember that moment because I was awestruck by the beauty of my country, by the richness, the diversity of culture. And I remember sitting in a taxi with my tío Marcos, my uncle Marcos, my mom's brother. And I remember sitting there with him, and all of a sudden, we're stuck in traffic, and I hear this knocking on the window. And I look over, and I see this little girl. It's probably the same age as me. This little girl who lived on the streets and who was knocking on my window and mouthing, "Ayúdame, help me." And that moment, my uncle Marcos, he must have seen the heartbreak in my face, because at that moment, I thought to myself, here I am, coming back from the United States, a place of abundance, a place of opportunity. And one of the first people I interact with is this little girl that's living on the streets, probably hadn't bathed in weeks, and she was asking me, 10-year-old Jesus, for help. And at that moment was the first time in my life that I felt that calling, that I had that decision to serve, that I had to make that conscious decision, I want to help this little girl. I want to help change her life. And I remember the taxi driving away and my Uncle Marco saying to me, and I'll never forget these words, saying to me, "Papito, Bolivia puede ser un lugar muy bello, pero también muy feo." Bolivia can be a beautiful place, but it can also be very ugly. And those words haunt me to this day, because those words were my catalyst to take my life and define it as a life of service, as a life where I didn't want to see a world where you saw that little girl knocking on the window saying, "Ayúdame, help me." And I continued to ask myself that question as I grew up. And as a teenager, I read a lot about social justice. I read a lot about how can we make the world a better place? How can I make a difference? And when I was in high school, I was a member of the Future Hispanic Leaders of America group. And the FHLA group was an opportunity for me to serve as a mentor in my community, to be able to go out and speak to younger Latinos and remind them of the importance of staying in school, the importance of finishing their education. Mind you, I grew up here in Caldwell at a time where there were many external factors that affected one's ability to finish high school, much less go to college. And I remember going into classrooms and going back to that memory of me as a 10-year-old boy in Bolivia and thinking, I owe it to that person, I owe it to myself to be here as a role model and to help my community. I was also a member of the Key Club at Caldwell High School in order to serve the wider community of Caldwell High School in Caldwell. And at that moment, I realized this concept that carries through me every day, which is serving in any capacity that you can. Whether it's a small act or a big act, it's being there for people and it's taking care of them. Which leads me to 2006, my senior year in high school. And in particular, an event that was monumental for me, which was the Idaho Hispanic Youth Symposium. I remember going to the Idaho Hispanic Youth Symposium because it was one of the first times that I had the opportunity of meeting other Latinos, other older Latinos who could serve as role models for me. And I remember in particular meeting one person, Arnold Hernandez from the College of Idaho. And I remember meeting Arnold because at that point I was still undecided. I didn't know if I wanted to go to the College of Idaho. And I remember talking with Arnold and Arnold telling me, come to the College of Idaho, come pursue your dream of fighting for social justice and come learn from the best. Come learn how we can take over the universe. And I'll never forget that because I came to the College of Idaho and I remember that HYS memory because that was my catalyst to coming to the College of Idaho and also meeting all of these role models within the Latino community. For me, it was life-changing because it set me on that path. And for many of those participants in the symposium, it was the first time they even thought college was possible. It was the first time they were exposed to other role models within their community. So here I am at the College of Idaho. And true to my goal to fight for social justice, my freshman year, I went to Peru. And I had an internship with a nonprofit that served the poorest county in Peru. And I remember getting up super early in the morning, taking a 12-hour bus ride to the middle of nowhere Andes, and working with farmers in an area that had been struck by drought, and helping them with how to fundraise, how to ask for grants, how to ask for funding for the equipment they needed. And once again, serving in any capacity that you can. And at this point, I felt like I was truly serving this community in Peru. I came back to the College of Idaho, came back to Idaho after my trip to Peru, and I became part of the Student Senate and the Community Relations Committee. And my goal with the Student Senate was to bridge what I saw was this gap between the wider Caldwell community and the College of Idaho community, and in particular, the Latino community, because we have a very big population of Latino people here in Caldwell, and I wanted to serve as a role model for those younger folks to say, yes, I can go to college, I can be at the College of Idaho. 2010 was a very special year for me. In the spring, I traveled to Guatemala. My better half, Michelle, along with other Yotes, we fundraised and we went down to Guatemala for spring break. And I remember that because someone told me, why are you guys going to Guatemala? You could go to Miami Beach for spring break. And I thought, the heck do I get out of going to Miami Beach? I want to go help people. We went down to Guatemala, and I'll never forget the sense of joy that we all had when we saw the faces of the family that we helped. We built a house for them, and it wasn't anything fancy. It was a cement floor, cement walls, and mind you, I was helping build a house, so I kind of questioned the quality of the work. But nevertheless, we built a house for these folks, for this family, and they were so happy. And that stuck with me because I thought about my life in the U.S. and I thought about the people I was exposed to and that comment someone had made about spring break in Miami. And I thought, what is life all about? Is it about me going out and having fun 24/7, buying all these fancy toys, all these big houses? Or is it about serving people? Is it about serving my local community and my global community in the case of my trip to Guatemala? The fall of 2010, I felt like was the culmination of a lot of the work I was doing within development. I went to Washington, D.C., and I interned with the Inter-American Development Bank. And that experience was, for me, extremely empowering because I was exposed to so many different people from all over the world that had the same goal of social justice and of helping one another. And it was incredible to me to be at the Inter-American Development Bank because I saw firsthand the initiatives that would have a direct impact on people like that little girl that I saw in La Paz in 1999. And I thought to myself, this is incredible. These are the policies that set in motion the events that can then help people at the ground level. And for me, it was a very incredible experience too, because it showed me the power that each one of us has, especially when you get up to that level of policy, and especially at a place like the Inter-American Development Bank. Came back to Idaho, graduated in the spring of 2011, and at that point, I was done with everything, but I wanted to do one more internship. And I remember in this building meeting the folks from the Mexican consulate, and I interned with them, and that was an experience that opened up my eyes to a reality that I had not seen firsthand. And that was going with the attorneys from the Mexican consulate out to the jails, out to the prisons here in Idaho, and talking with the undocumented folks that had been in jail, that had been in prison, and how the Mexican consulate attorneys fought for their rights. And I thought to myself, here is another opportunity, another decision to serve my community. And in that case, I saw firsthand the work that the Mexican consulate did to help the community here, and for me to be able to serve the Mexican community here in Idaho. My time ended at the College of Idaho. I left kicking and screaming, and I went into the professional world, and I went into the world of banking. And once again, I thought to myself, what can I do to serve? How can I help people? And the first thing I did was help people with their financial literacy, whether that was saving for a rainy day fund, whether that was saving to build a house, to buy a house, or whether that was just figuring out what the heck a credit score was. I felt like I could be a resource for so many different families and so many people in our community. I especially remember when I was working for a local credit union, and my mission to serve was represented by having marketing materials that were culturally and linguistically appropriate for Spanish-speaking people. And in true Jesus Tarifa fashion, I raised hell until we made it happen. And we finally had materials that I was proud to show to people, proud to go to the Mexican consulate and do presentations on financial literacy and help the community with those resources. It's been a wild ride since I got into banking, and one of the biggest satisfactions I've had is my career in mortgage lending. And when a real estate agent calls me and says, Jesus, I've got a client for you. I've got this client. I've got this refugee family. They're wanting to buy a house. It's a complicated loan. Can we make it happen? And it's a lot of work, but it's the most satisfying work that I do. Because in my industry, I feel a lot of people are chasing money. A lot of people are chasing recognition. But at the end of the day, for me, it's about helping people, and it's about helping refugees, first-time home buyers, Spanish-speaking folks, and having them realize the potential of the American dream, creating wealth, leveraging that equity to put their kids through college, leveraging that equity to start businesses. It truly is the hallmark of being an American and living the American dream, and I'm proud to be able to do that through my work as a mortgage loan officer. The year 2012, I received a phone call from a fellow Yote. And once again, the decision to serve was right in front of me. The call was from Adan de la Paz. And he told me, Jesus, do you remember the Hispanic Youth Symposium? Of course, Adan, I remember the Hispanic Youth Symposium. It changed my life. And he tells me, unfortunately, there will not be a Hispanic Youth Symposium going forward because of budget cuts at the federal level. And I thought to myself, I thought about all the people I met at the Hispanic Youth Symposium, all the way from Arnold, all the way to the students I met, all the way to the different role models that were present at that symposium. And I thought, this is it. We got a call to action. So we got together and we volunteer-based event 2014 in the fall. We had the first volunteer-run Hispanic Youth Symposium at Idaho State University. And I couldn't believe it. We were so emotional when we finally put it together. It was an incredible moment to see all those students there and to realize that we made this possible for them and that they would have the opportunities that we had when we went to the Hispanic Youth Symposium in the past. Through my involvement with the Hispanic Youth Symposium, I also became part of the Idaho Latino Scholarship Foundation. And my call to action there was reading the stories of students who grow up in the local area, students who come from families that make $15,000, $20,000 a year. They're supporting five, six people within the family. These students have perfect GPAs. They have extracurricular activities. They play sports. They have this dream to propel their family forward. And I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe the dedication these students have. And I thought to myself, it is my goal, it is my duty, it is my mission, it is my decision to serve this community, to be able to make sure that these students can go to college. Some of our recipients of the scholarship have come to the College of Idaho. They're in Washington, D.C. now. They're serving as policy analysts. Other recipients have gone to other universities here in Idaho. One of them is currently in New York City at the J.P. Morgan Chase headquarters, shadowing the executives. And I can't believe it, because we made that possible. Each one of us deciding to serve our community made it possible for these young people to have these opportunities. With the College of Idaho, with the Business Advisory Council, once again, the call to serve. I had met Doug Brigham when he was working at Title I, and when he came over to the College of Idaho with Jim Everett, he called me up. And I'm glad I answered the phone, because Doug asked me if I wanted to serve the school by being part of the Business Advisory Council. And I love the work that we do, connecting students with internships, connecting students with job opportunities, and connecting businesses and employers with the incredible talent pool that we have here at the College of Idaho. Last year, another fellow Yote, Ali Robbie, called me and said, Jesus, I know your passion for helping people. I know your passion for preventing homelessness. I would like you to serve on the advisory board of Jesse Tree. And I said, yes. I said, yes, Ali, I would love to be part of Jesse Tree. Once again, making that conscious decision to serve my community. And I think about that moment, going back to 1999, when an opportunity came to me, an opportunity to either shy away from what my uncle said was sometimes the ugly side of my country, or the opportunity to help and change reality, change the world that I lived in, to be able to make a difference. And I carry that with me every day. I carry that with me, whether it's in my mortgage business, whether it's with my volunteer work in the community. And in closing, I ask each of one of you watching this, and everyone here in our very large audience, I ask you, the next time opportunity literally knocks on your window, what are you gonna do about it? What will you decide to do? Will you decide to take action? Will you decide to serve? Will you decide to make a difference in the world, or will you ignore it? And as we face the next few years, we're faced with tremendous challenges, both as a society and as a world. And I would like to think that if each of us took that moment to think about the impact that we can have on one another and on our world, that we can create a better world for everyone. Thank you. And most importantly, go Yotes!